nice evening and the food truck night. I think everybody can agree that the longest line is definitely the lobster truck, which I tried. But I also did make the rounds to a couple of
We hit a lot, yeah.
So, it was a very fun event, as always. And I want to thank everybody coming out early this morning. I know sometimes by the second or third day, everyone's a little bit tired. It's been kind of a long day's meetings ongoing. So hopefully this gives you some insight into some of the trends that are happening from not just the promotional world, but also we're going to talk about some macro trend information that we gather from our shopper insight studies that will shine a light on not just what's going on from the actual data, but also from a consumer sentiment perspective when, as it relates to private label. So with that, let's jump in. I think everybody in this room can agree there has been disruption's been tossed around a lot, but I think it's coming to a point of relevance as far as CPG and consumables that can't be denied. And it's exciting in many ways, but it's also a little bit scary because it's a new world and there are a lot of things to get your arms around. So gone are the days of people making a list, taking a look at the circular, going to the store, the same store that they always go to, and then picking up the things that they need. Now they have so many more options as far as not just the in-store experience, but also the new emerging technologies such as buy online, pick up on store, and some of the other things in terms of delivery services and online ordering. So we'll talk a little bit about that as well. The connected shopper is really what's driving this innovation. They're the ones that are in control, and I think the power has shifted over the past 2 to 3 years to the extent that the brands and the retailers are really trying to catch up to what their needs and wants are in the marketplace. The other thing is, with emerging technologies that are available, the other things aren't going away. So there's still a need, and we'll show this in the shopper data, to still focus, especially with certain demographic groups, on some of those traditional media. But it's being augmented and supplemented, and in some cases, largely used in the digital realm as well.
Is it working? All right, there we go.
Sure, yeah. So one of the other things that came out of our survey, we do these about 6 times a year, and we use different panels each time of 1,000 to 1,200 household primary shoppers. And we want to find out from a year-over-year trend what the shifts are that are happening from a media usage standpoint as well as a decision-making standpoint. And that's a really important element. I think attribution is becoming one of those things that's becoming more and more difficult to do, because what we found in our survey is it's not one thing or the other, it's all of it. And so the challenge with that is budgets aren't growing at the same pace. So you have to figure out how to be smarter with what you're doing in terms of not just what you've done before with the traditional means through the circulars and some online activity, but you also have to start to leverage, especially for those younger and upcoming demographic groups, the new technologies that they are connected to all the time. So one of the things that we saw was shoppers just aren't loyal. They're willing to switch brands at a rate of 73%. This is a smidge down from the last survey that we did, which said 78%, but directionally it's about the same. If they see something that's compelling in terms of an offer or some sort of incentive, it is entirely likely that they are open to trying new things. Now that is especially true when you get into millennials and the generation behind them. Also, they're starting to really embrace and adapt mobile. And that's something that we have seen in the past surveys that we've done that's been a little on the fringe, especially as it relates to consumers and CPG. People just were not actually leveraging those as tools in their decision-making process. That's starting to really change. We also wanted to find out just, are people planning on doing more online or mobile shopping? And at a rate of 64% for online shopping, that's true, and for mobile, it's 44%. So we are starting to reach a level of significance with this. Whereas before, yes, the transactional numbers definitely tell the story of it's not terribly impactful. You can see from these numbers and statistics, it's really starting to matter. And I think that what we're looking at from the consumables and grocery spaces, that's where the growth can occur. And that's where really there's a lot of opportunities. One of the other things that we looked at that's not on this slide is the anticipated change in behavior based on the new technologies that we have available today. People are saying that 44% of them plan on altering the way that they do their grocery shopping because of these new technologies. That is meaningful simply because out of every type of shopping behavior, grocery shopping and consumable shopping is probably the most well-entrenched and habitual of any sort of shopping that exists. So one of the things that we're starting to see is a real interest in specialty products online in consumables. So things like organic, paleo, keto, those types of things are really gaining some traction. And they're starting to really take off as far as people don't always know what stores to go into to buy those things, but they certainly know that they can buy them online. And they're looking for them there. So at any point during this conversation, you guys have any questions, feel free to raise your hand or shout out, because I want you to stop me if there's a statistic that jumps out at you or you have a question about. We also have all of this information broken out by demographics, and we'll show that in a minute.
And we're going to share these slides after.
We'll share
so
slides
you don't have to worry about taking pictures.
So you don't have to take pictures and take up space in your phones to do that. So MarketTrack actually started as a promotional tracking company, and over time started to think about, well, promotions are certainly an action driver, more toward the end of the buying cycle. There are so many more things that influence shoppers today, whether it be TV commercials or things that people are seeing in their social feeds or things that are coming across their mobile devices. So those are some of the things that we started to also monitor. And you can see from this view, those are the different media types that we have access to that we can provide to our clients and our partners. So it's pretty comprehensive, and it really gives that 360 view of what's happening to influence shopper behavior. Looking at anything through one of these lenses is an incomplete picture because there are all of those different things that are hitting the consumer and the shopper at any given time. We also then layer that information with the consumer and shopper data to validate the things that we're starting to surmise. So what we want to do is make sure that we're doing a constant logic check to say, is this in fact the direction that the industry is moving? And the reason that we did that is because we worked with over 2,000 different companies in all verticals and in all segments that really have a lot of the same questions. And what we wanted to do is start to put some numbers around what shopper behavior actually looks like and what they say that they're using. Let's take a little look at what the differences are between the use of these media types, not just for their planning purposes, but also in the moment. This is a new opportunity now that everyone is so connected with their clients. I'm sure everybody's been walking down the store aisles and maybe have been bumped into by a cart or almost run over by somebody who has their head down looking at their phone. And this is just now the new normal. People are using these things in the moment, and so that leaves opportunity for people to message them at that time to potentially change what their plans are in terms of buying and trying new products. So you can see from circulars, and this is a number that surprises a lot of people because you'll often see mainstream media saying, oh, print's dead, it's going away. It's still very relevant, and especially for some of those audiences in the 30-plus range. Those are the folks that are still very heavily relying. It also varies by where people live. So if you're talking about urban areas, most of the statistics skew a little bit more toward the digital side just because people are oriented that way, and that's where they are. But you can still think about the people in rural areas, that that's their main access point to deals and offers. There's also still a heavy use of couponing, digital and print. So I think that's an interesting point that came out of this data. Does this surprise anybody? Is anybody in the audience that thought that would be higher or lower in any direction? I will say that that print circular number has started to creep down a bit over the past 4 years that we've been conducting these surveys. Formerly, it was in the 70% range, and now it's starting to tick down a bit as people start to invest in their website experience and make it a really useful tool for shoppers to use as they're planning their trips. I think we can all relate to this picture. Anybody who says that they're just doing one thing at a time, whether it be while they watch TV, that's just not the case anymore. People are generally watching TV, they're on their laptops, they're on their cellular devices. So if you think about what that means from a marketing perspective and a messaging perspective, you have opportunity to capture them at three different points during the time where they're a bit of a captive audience, not to mention the traditional ways of getting them through TV commercials. So all of these things are important, and the degree to which that they're important and influential varies by what age groups you're talking about.
Quick question regarding that. The multi-screen use. Are there, are you tracking, or is it possible to track when you'll have interactivity between a, say, a TV show and the audience, like in The Walking Dead, Talking Dead, after The Walking Dead, they'll ask and do user polls by their mobile apps while they're watching a TV. Is that trackable, or are you,
Yeah, that's absolutely something that we look at, and I think that's a big task that a lot of our agencies are being charged with. So we work with a lot of agency clients as well. And they're trying to figure out what are those levers and what are those tools that really drive conversion. And so what we found through the survey information is when somebody sees a commercial on TV, 65% of the time they'll go out and do research on a product if it interests them online. And generally they have the devices sitting right next to them or on their lap to be able to do that. So they're able to then tie those things together. Whereas before, you really had a lot of disparate groups working on these initiatives and not sharing that data with each other. The more engaged clients that we have, and the people who are doing the more advanced analytics, are starting to connect those dots. And they're starting to see some real returns in terms of ROI of their total marketing programs as opposed to components of those. Does that make sense? Let's talk a little bit about the shopper data. Obviously, people very much are using private label and store brands. They do like the fact that they're able to have very, very comparable products, and sometimes in their view, superior products from that perspective. Now, that's interesting, because if you can look at the chart to your right and left, They really are starting to embrace it from different ways through the age groups. And I think the reason why that is the digital native audience, those folks in the younger segments who have never known a world without digital, all of it blends together a bit more for them. And they don't really know how to make the distinction always, because brands are becoming very good at making their private label products, and we'll talk about this a bit, segmented and targeted to certain audiences.
Oh.
And I don't think this surprises anyone. What's the driver? Their price. People do like a deal, and if they see something that they perceive to be comparable or the same, they'll gravitate toward every single time. Now you're starting to also see retailers embrace this concept, and this has been going on for a couple of years now, where they will pair in the same ad block their store label products in addition to the main labels, really calling out that direct comparison in price. interesting for the retailers, somewhat problematic for some of the brands that are paying for those placements that may not want to be in the same ad block with that comparison so directly drawn. When you talk about the quality of store brand products, there's really starting to be a understanding that they are similar, if not the same. But again, the younger segment hasn't really been exposed to the fact that some of these are actually not brands on their own. So I think that the reason that that number for the 18 to 20 is a bit higher is because they perceive some of these store brands to be just another manufacturer, just another regular brand, which means it's accomplishing probably the goal it was set out to do. And then we talked a little bit about ingredients as well, the same story. Most people perceive them to be on par, if not very similar to the ingredients in regular manufacturer brands. And I think that that's an interesting point because the industry has come a long way from the black and white labels on cans that used to exist. There's not a stigma attached anymore. And in fact, some of these private label and store brands are very much preferred to the actual national brands, not just for price, but also for the fact that people think the quality is the same. This talks a little bit about some of the segmentation happening, and this is one specific retailer that we did a study on, all the different variances of what their private label and store brands look like. So if you were a consumer and there was no way, from a visual perspective at least, to tie that back to what our store is, I think that it's very difficult to discern that that is what it is in fact. And it matters less. It matters less today. People are embracing these. So this is a good strategy by the retailers to drive that interest and drive that traffic through things that are actually going to benefit them in the end. And then you can also see that by need base or by attribute, they're starting to segment them out there too. So you've got people really focused on natural and organic. There's an answer for that. There's also, you know, those exclusive ones that exist for certain retailers. And so it's become a lot more complex than it ever used to be, which is good news, but it's also a bit of a challenge sometimes. You're trying to figure out how to compete in this crowded and somewhat, you know, we're conflating some issues here with these different groupings. And I think a lot of people are starting to find these things being researched online as well. And we'll talk about the digital aspect of that next. Before we get into the digital part, there's also a lot of support coming from the retail community in terms of how they support private label and store brands. You can see Walmart jump through times in the number of amount of promoted products that were store brands for them. That's fairly significant when we look at the rest of the retailers that are saying they're flat or in some cases going down a bit. So they put a very big focus on this, and it shows in the promotion of these items. Offer types really matter, and the reason that we know this is because a lot of our more in-depth partnerships with our clients actually show, we line up the sales data that they get from the Nielsen IRI with our promotional data, and we can see lift based on placement and the attributes that go with those placements. And so if you think about offer types, BOGO is one of the ones traditionally, and we just had this talk with the HBC folks yesterday, that is usually the one that provides the most lift from a sales perspective. It's interesting that in this particular realm, there are grouping ads, so those family ads that exist, those are the ones that are most predominant in the grocery space, which I think is an interesting, you know, kind of discrepancy between the other categories. Does anybody have questions about this or surprised by the types of offers that are being put out there? some cases, these family brands are direct comparisons with the regular manufacturers as well. Here we see some volatility, and this is really about digital promotion of store brands. And this speaks to the fact that people are really still trying to figure it out. It also really calls into attention the fact that digital is agile. And if something's not working, they can very easily change courses and kind of shift gears. And you can see where that's happening at different points in time, of course, the past year. The messaging also varies when you talk about digital, because in some instances they're using it to engage, in some instances they're using it to drive home attribute-based statements. And so when you think about things like Super Bowl and other main grocery-centric events, this is a very important component. You know, building that awareness is one element to, on an eventual basis, building that rapport with the shopper. And so the digital space, what they know is that those younger audiences that are very connected are gravitating and in some cases they need to be convinced. And so a bit more description, a bit more about what those positive attributes are is critical for them to have that flexibility from the digital realm to go ahead and put that messaging out, whether it be a competitive threat they're reacting to. That's one of the things that we see a lot. Then also just an education component as well. You can see just a few examples here of some of the things that people are doing. Some of them have actual price points in them. Some of those are more attribute-based. But at the end of the day, we do have some flexibility when you talk about digital. You can modify course quickly if necessary, and also react to new emerging products. One of the things that we notice that when there's a new rollout for a product, there's a very quick reaction in digital, which means that they're really kind of leveraging the strength of that media type. And then yet another component to this is social media, and I think this is one that has a lot of people baffled, and it is a bit confusing in some instances, but what it does is give a vehicle that's fairly low cost to be able to talk more in depth and engage with the audience on those different positive attributes that do something apart. And it also reaches different demographics than it would if they were running just a regular TV spot or a circular ad. And so we'll see more and more of this where people are doing creative things in the world of social so that they can not just push out messaging to try and drive action, but also have a conversation with their audience. That's a really important element for a lot of brands. They understand that the younger age groups are very driven by companies they perceive to do good or to have those sorts of components to them that will be viewed as positive from a consumption standpoint. Social media is a great vehicle for them to do that. And the other nice thing about it is it's not really very high cost either. So at the end of the day, what does this all mean? It means that there's a lot of different things going on, and with a view of just one of those components, you're probably not going to be able to identify areas of opportunity or why you might not be getting the lift that you think you should be getting from the promotion side of this thing. Or there could be things in digital that you need to kind of maybe build a bridge between the traditional means of advertising and the folks that are working in the agencies as well as the digital teams to make sure that that message amplification is happening for you and make sure that from a cohesive messaging standpoint, what is hitting the market really lines up to what your brand promise is and what the things that you want to highlight per audience also can be. And segmentation across these different media types is also a really good tactic because the same messages don't always transfer across media types and audiences. So really figuring out what's going on, not just from a competitive standpoint, but also within your own organization, can help you be more successful and make you also more aware of where there's areas of opportunity, maybe that are being missed today. So with that, I'll open it up for questions. Does anybody have any questions?
You mentioned before the digital, they gives them obviously the opportunity to switch and be very adaptable. Do a lot of retailers running ads, whether it's private brand or branded, do they do a lot of A/B testing when they throw out digital ads?
Yes, they do. And they also are being much more strategic as it relates to segmenting their audiences. And so that's one of the things that's going to continue to grow. Personalization in and of itself is a very nice idea, and I think it's important. I think segmentation's audience type is probably a good starting point for a lot of them, because they're not really able to do that personalization component just yet. But I think everyone's aware they are collecting data on us all the time, and that is something that's going to continue to grow. So making sure that you know your customer and know the segments within those audiences will help you make better decisions about where to place your bets, where to go ahead and focus on it, and then hopefully that transfers into conversions for sales and also success of the brand overall.
Thank you.
Are you doing any studies on where in the country advertising is hitting the most, like the North is online hitting the best, down south, mobile,
Yeah, we actually track everything, as Joe mentioned, from circulars, TV, to online activity, as well as e-commerce. So we can see some of that information as far as success rates. What we know is that there's a lot of focus in urban and big city areas on very related pricing. And so that's one of the finer points that I think a lot of people miss. There's a lot of very specific price changes happening at the store level that we can get to and show what that actually looks like. And as far as efficacy of ads, we have done some studies on who's using what, which age groups are actually finding these things more effective, and which of them are converting based on that. There's a lot of data that didn't make it in this presentation just because of time constraints. And so if anybody would like a copy of something specific from a demographic perspective or additional things like what you just asked, feel free to give me your card and I can send you some additional data if that would be of interest. But these surveys that we conduct are very rich. There's just not usually time to talk about every single part of them.
In regards to everyday points outside of promotion, is there a certain point that private label can be too low where the consumer thinks that there's a quality issue?
I think that really comes down to making sure that they understand what the attributes are in comparison to the other things. So as far as, usually it comes in the form of some sort of news story about quality that comes out if there is a concern. Generally speaking though, most consumers just need educated, and there's all sorts of vehicles for people to do that in terms of if they don't understand what a private label or store brand is about, making them know that not just is it priced in some cases lower, but also in some cases the ingredients are superior. And that's where the education component really needs to come in.
Did your slide about the obviously the greater sales lift doing BOGOs or doing you ever look at how that, I guess I call it the efficiency of that promotions 3 months later, 6 months later, are you looking at just pure lift? How do you kind of parse that data?
So what we are able to do is we are able to see the attributes of each ad, so whether it be where it's placed within the circular or where we're in the digital realm. One of the things is digital shelf that's an emerging sort of conversation that's going on. And that price point is going to win the league based on previous sort of historical data. So we can also get into the predictive aspect of that as well. But the attributes of the ad, there are six different dimensions that we evaluate those on, and then we can line up the sales data to then say, okay, so the trending that we're seeing is that this offer type is one of the ones that is most successful. Or adjacencies are another thing that we take a look at. Are there complementary or supplementary products placed near that that would also give them additional lift? So it's a combination of multiple factors that are evaluated in conjunction with the sales information to see what are those trends for that particular category or segment.